folks, fun little topic for you today. Pretty quick one, I'm hoping. We've talked about it in a couple of our videos so far. I've even given you one very primitive example of creating loops, but I wanted to do some more real practical ones that would help you start to build your own and that you could probably realistically reuse a fair bit. So we're going to cover looping through cubes within a TM1 instance. We're going to look at looping through dimensions within cubes. And what we're going to actually build is something that's going to extract our cube names and dimension names from the model. So you can see nested loops as well, and doing text output. So lots of fun to be had. I think this will be useful. If you've never written a line of code before, you'll still get this. This is really basic and you'll be able to reuse the examples I'm showing you. And if you've written lots of code and script before, you know exactly what a loop is and why and when to use it. But you've never written one with TM1 before, I think this will probably satisfy you as well. And you'll see how we can get some of the core objects that we need. So lots of fun to be had. Let's get started.
So I've created a new process. This is going to be a script only source process. Don't have a view or anything like that. I'm going to jump right into the prologue. I don't actually need any parameters at all for this just yet. I might make it a little fancier later on, but for now, let's get to the prologue and create the three variables that I know for sure I need. So when I create these variables, I like to create and set them up front. When I create a variable that I'm going to use for counting, for example, counting the cubes or iterating through the cubes in a model, I will name it for the object I'm iterating through so that I know when I'm reading my code what I was doing. And I will also set that to 1, just to make my life a little easier. I'm also going to set a variable for my file name, just so that I could easily change that later. This guy's going to be a string, and we'll make that string extract dimensions in use .csv. So we'll do our very basic loop first, which is again using the while function, which I will enclose in parens. So everything that's going to set this condition is going to be contained within parens. My condition is going to be first looking for my cubes. And so while I cubes is less than or equal to the number of cubes in my instance. So how do I get that? So that comes from the dimension size of a particular dimension that I have, and you will have, and everyone will have. It's a control dimension called cubes. To close our loop and iterate through this correctly, I have to say iCubes is equal to iCubes plus 1. So every time we step through this loop until the end, what we're going to have is the value of I cubes incrementing up by 1. Eventually, that value should be greater than the number of cubes in our model, at which point we'll exit the loop. So now let's think about what we want to happen while we're going through the loop. So let's do an ASCII output so that we can see what's happening here. And we're going to do that to our V file name. So we created a simple variable to store that so we can change it easily later. And what do we actually want to put in that file? Well, just for a fun test, let's do number to string of our value for I cubes. And I'll close my parens properly here. I can see in the editor, of course, with these little boxes that show me where my parens are closed. And think for a moment what this is going to look like. So basically through every step, we're adding 1 to I cubes and we're putting the value, outputting the value to a file. Let's see what happens when we run that. So it was successful. If we take a look at this, we can see something. It's not particularly interesting, but we will actually get a count of cubes in the model. So there are 86 cubes in this model. Might be much more interesting to see this with the actual cube names. And to do that, all we need is another variable, and I'll call this VCubeName. And let's output our VCubeName as well. So that's going to be in our text file. And I just need to simply comma separate anything that I want to output to that ASCII file. But now we need to make sure we set this. So how are we going to set our VCubeName? Well, to do that, we just need to know a way to convert the index value of our I cubes to a name. And we can do that with dimNM. That will allow me to choose a dimension. So the dimension we want, once again, that control dimension called cubes, and then the index value of the element in that control dimension, which is going to be our I cubes value. That's going to step from 1 through to the number of cubes, and using that index, we'll pull the value back. So let's run that and see what that looks like. If we take a look at that, we can see both our integer value for our I cubes that we were previously extracting, as well as the cube name that matches that index value. And each of those cube names represents an element in our control cubes dimension. One of the things that we're getting with that is a whole bunch of control objects. So that's something we're probably going to want to clean up after. But now let's focus on getting exactly what we want, with a nested loop to iterate through the dimensions that are contained within those cubes. So anytime I'm using a nested loop or any set of nested logic where I'm creating a test, I like to use a format where I tab or indent those to make sure that it's a bit more readable when I'm looking at it and that I know one thing is happening within another. What's going to happen in this nested loop, though, is going to be a little different than the last time. We had it really easy. We had a control dimension that told us each of the cube names that were in our model. But we don't have anything like that to test the number of dimensions within those cubes. To get that, I'm going to use the tabdim function, which each time I pass it a cube name and an integer value, it will return the dimension name that occupies that position within the cube, which sounds like a lot, but basically if I have a two-dimension cube and I ask for 1, I'll get the first dimension, 2, I'll get the second. If I ask for 3, I'll get a null value. So all we have to do is make sure that for the cube that we're on in this step of the code, that what's retrieved for our dimensions integer that we're going to be iterating, we just have to make sure that that's not null. So that's going to open our nested loop. We want to make sure that we close that loop as well. But what we want is for our ASCII output, our text output, to happen within this loop. We want each one of those dimensions named. So I'll close the loop, but I'm not iterating on anything yet. So let's iterate on our I dimension value, just like we did on our I cubes value. And not forget, and you may do this the first few times you create these, is a very easy thing to forget, but when you step through a particular cube, that dimension value is going to reach the limit for that first cube. We need to reset that before we go through the next cube. So you definitely want to make your inner nested variable there reset back to 1. So we do have something now that's going to iterate through both all of the cubes and then the dimensions within those cubes, but it's not going to be very interesting unless we actually do something new for those dimension names. So I'm going to create another variable, which is going to be my dimension, let's call it dimension name, and that's again going to be a string variable, and we're going to set this one as well just a little bit differently than we set our cube name. But we're just going to steal what we're using to return the dimension here. So if I steal this guy, as it steps through the dimensions in the cube, so asking for dimension 1, dimension 2, dimension 3, and so on, that's going to be setting the value of my V dimension name, which I'm then going to include in my ASCII output. So let's save that, run it, and see what we get. Take a look at my file now. We can see that each of our cube names is repeated as we'd expect for each dimension contained within that cube. So these are my dimension names contained within each of my cubes. Now if I look down, of course I see what we did want to eliminate here, which is all of these control objects that are filling my file. So let's tidy those up. So we'll close this and take a look at our code. So there are two approaches that I could use to solve this. It almost doesn't matter for this one which approach I take, so I'll show you both of them. The first one would be just a simple if test once we have our cube name as we're iterating through our cubes and see if the first character, so the substring picking the first character with a length of 1, if that's a curly brace and we know it's a control object, and I can skip that. That's really easy. Just close my if statement there with an end if, and now we're going to ignore any cubes with that control character. And I can save that and run it, and you can see how that would work. Take a look at our file. So that's great. That's one way of doing it. But tests like that usually aren't the best way. So I'll show you what is. And maybe first explain why it isn't. So think about what's happening as we're stepping through the logic of this process. So we're going through each one of our cubes. And in this case, for every one of those cubes, we're going to see if it's a control object, and then we'll skip using the dimensions. But we're still going through all of the cubes. If this were something that were really large and long running, which of course it's not, this is a sub-second process, but what I'm doing is a lot of logic that I don't need to, because I could be pre-filtering only the cubes I want up front. And of course, that's almost always the best approach to something. You wouldn't go shopping for something at every store and then just ignore those stores where you didn't find it. Far better to just shortlist the stores where you either think you'll find it or know you'll find it. You want to do that up front, not after you step through each one. So let's get rid of our if statement and create a pre-filtered list. And this is a great excuse for me to show you what is probably the most useful and most used approach to iterating through a particular set of elements, and that's using subsets. Now, to do that, I'm going to have to change a couple of things. So the first thing I'm going to change here is I don't actually want my dimension size. I'm going to use subset get size as my function, and that expects two things. So first it expects which dimension, and my dimension here, the control dimension, for cubes, I'm going to pass that a subset name as well, called my subset. Now, at the great risk of losing folks who don't know MDX, I am going to create an MDX-based dynamic subset temporarily for the purposes of this function. Now, you guys don't have to do that. If you've not worked with MDX yet, we're going to have lots of videos on it. It really deserves its own set, but for the purposes of this, if you just go create a subset that you want and save that as a permanent subset, as long as it's a public one, that's perfectly fine. While MDX is incredibly powerful, it's not always for the faint of heart. So if you want to ignore this next bit, feel free to, and just have a subset called my subset that you've created. So I'm going to create that subset before I do anything else, before I go into my loop with a subset create by MDX. Pass the subset name, so the name of the new subset, don't need to worry about the dimension, that can be interpreted from the MDX that I'm using here, which, if you're interested, is very simply all members except those which contain that control character. One other quick thing, and I'll make it a little easier to see here, just put this on another line, is that I'm using comma 1 when I create that subset, because as of TM1 10.2.2 FP4, we now support the creation of temporary views and subsets just by including that optional parameter there. If it's set to 0, that's not temporary. 1 is temporary. If you're not at a version that is that recent, you just need to delete the subset. It's pretty easy, but it does save you a step to be able to create temporary ones and prevents any locking. Last code change we want to do is to stop using the dimension to retrieve our cube names from and start using the subset that we have. So I'm going to do subset get element name. We're going to pass that the dimension name, which is of course our cubes, the subset name, which is my subset, and then the index, which, like we were using before, is just our I cubes. And we'll save that. And let me just tighten the code up a little tiny bit here so that we can see things better. And we'll step through it. Exactly what's happening at each step. Get rid of some of our spaces here, make this a little more readable. And now we'll try to slow down time and take a look at what's happening at every step. So ignoring the first set of variables, we can move on to setting our file name. This is going to be the file that we'll create and populate with all of our records. Next, we have our subset creation, which of course is temporary and doesn't really exist, but I'm showing you here what that would look like. And now we begin looping, where initially I cubes has a value of 1, and the size of our subset, that's going to be persistent throughout, is 11. Next, we get our cube name, which, because I cubes is still 1, is going to be hotel assumptions. Then we create our nested loop by asking if the first dimension of hotel assumptions is empty, which of course it's not. As we can see in our next step, where we're populating our V dimension name with that value, which is our weekly performance dimension. And then we get to what we're really trying to do here, which is to dump these out to a file, which we start doing with our file name that we've already specified. We change iCubes to a string so we can write it as a 1. And then we have our hotel assumptions, which is our cube, and weekly performance, which is our dimension name currently. Next, we add 1 to our I dimensions value, so that's going to be 2. And then at the end, of course, we go back to the beginning of this loop to see, is the condition still true? If I ask for the second dimension of that cube, do I get a value or is it empty? We still have a value, so we continue to loop. And for this cube, once we ask for dimension number 4, we get back a null value because there are only 3 dimensions. Then we move on to the final part of the original loop, which resets our dimension counter and increments our cube counter. So of course we'll continue to do that until we reach the very end of our cubes based on the subset that we created to get those cube names, and we've iterated through all of the dimensions of that cube. So in this video you saw how to create a loop, how to populate a text file, how to nest one loop within another loop, how to iterate the elements in a dimension, the dimensions in a cube, and the elements within a subset. And those type of loops are really the most common ones, but if there's one that you need, you want to know, feel free to stick a comment in on the video and I'll be happy to try to find an answer for you if I don't already have one. I hope you found that useful, and thanks for your time.